This brown rock could power the world with electricity for decades to come and with zero emission. Yes, it is controversial, but it's true. It's estimated that the United States could power its entire population with clean energy for more than 1,000 years based on just its own reserves of this stuff. But the US is not even the country with the most reserves. That would be India. But in general, it's found in many places around the world. So how does a rock power the planet? Well, it's not the rock itself, but the element thorium found within this rock. Einstein's famous equation E equals mc² states that mass is equal to a lot of energy. And this rock has a lot of thorium, which can be converted to energy via nuclear processes. Now you might say, but I thought nuclear power was bad and dangerous. Well, it may have been in the past, particularly when a different kind of nuclear fuel is used, but with thorium, it can become a lot less dangerous. How do we extract this near limitless amount of energy to solve our energy needs for the foreseeable future? To understand this, let's review how nuclear power plants work and how thorium can change the game and shift our paradigm about nuclear energy, which in principle can be safe with little to no environmental impact. That's coming up right now. People ask me how I choose my topics to make a video on. In today's case, I was inspired after watching two videos on Magellan TV, today's sponsor, called Fukushima, Robots in Hell, and simply Fukushima Province, Japan. The former reviews the events that led to the 2011 disaster and shows clips from film footage actually taken by robots inside the contaminated power plant. The second video shows what life is like today near the contaminated zone. It's a touching story about unimaginable devastation, but also recovery and human resilience. Magellan has thousands of equally remarkable documentaries like this. It's a new kind of documentary service created by the filmmakers themselves. Featured topics include science, history, travel, and technology. Magellan has a special offer right now for Arvin Ash viewers. If you click the link in the description, you can get a free 1 month trial. You've got nothing to lose and a world of knowledge to gain that's available at your fingertips. So be sure to click the link in the description. I don't think even Einstein could have imagined the impact that his mass energy equivalence principle would have on the world. It comes from the theory of special relativity, which he postulated in 1905. The principle is simple. When you split some heavier atoms into lighter atoms, you get a lot of energy. So for example, an isotope of uranium, referred to as uranium-235 or U-235, is a fissile material. If you hit it with a neutron at the right speed, it will split into two lighter atoms, like barium-141 and krypton-92, plus three neutrons. These neutrons can then go on to hit other U-235 atoms, which again split into two lighter atoms and some extra neutrons. In this way, it can lead to a continuous chain reaction, producing more and more energy. Where does this energy come from? Well, if we consider the mass of uranium-235 plus one neutron that hits it, we get 236.053 unified atomic mass units. But now if we add up the mass on the right side of the equation, the barium-141, krypton-92, and three neutrons, we get an atomic mass of only 235.867. Where did the difference in the mass go? The mass went exactly into Einstein's equation. It became energy. Now the question is, where did this mass come from in the first place so that it could be converted to energy? As we discussed in a previous video about how the sun shines, it's all about the binding energy related to the strong nuclear force. Binding energy in this case relates to the energy needed to break the bonds between the protons and neutrons in the nucleus of atoms. In other words, it takes a lot of energy to keep protons and neutrons so tightly bound together in the nucleus. This comes from one of the fundamental forces of the universe called the strong nuclear force. This force, or energy, that keeps the protons and neutrons bound together contributes to the mass of the atom. So when the nucleus is split apart, some mass is lost in the process as less energy is required to keep the nucleus bound together. This is where the mass that's converted to energy comes from. Binding energy refers to the energy needed to break those nuclear bonds. The more energy that's needed to break the bonds of the nucleus of an atom, the higher the binding energy of the atom. An atom with higher binding energy is more stable than an atom with lower binding energy. You release energy when you go from lower binding energy to higher binding energy. It's the difference in binding energy that is released in the nuclear fission process. Uranium has a lower binding energy than the combined binding energies of barium and krypton. When uranium splits, the overall binding energy of the system increases. This means that krypton and barium are in a more stable and lower energy state than uranium. And in going to this more stable energy state, energy is released. But you might say, what can a difference of just 0.186 atomic mass units make? The answer is a lot. It's around 173 million electron volts, or MeV. For comparison, when you burn paper or a fossil fuel, each carbon atom consumed in the burning releases around 4 electron volts. So the nuclear process, with 173 million electron volts, releases about 40 million times more energy per atom than burning fossil fuels like petrol or gasoline. In general, 1 kilogram of uranium-235 corresponds to about 2.7 million kilograms of coal equivalent, depending on equipment and type of coal. It should be noted that U-235 can be split into other atoms as well, such as barium-144 and krypton-90 plus 2 neutrons, which releases even more energy, around 200 megaelectron volts. A nuclear power plant works in many ways just like a coal plant. You have some fuel you burn to heat water and turn it into steam. Then you have a steam turbine that then drives a generator which produces electricity. Then the steam is condensed into water again, and then reheated, turned into steam, and the process continues. But the nuclear plant is radically different to the coal plant in how it heats the water. In a coal plant, you have a boiler heated by burning coal, which you constantly feed into the furnace. A nuclear power plant is more complicated and technologically advanced, but the concept is still fairly simple. Inside the core, you have fuel rods containing your nuclear fuel. So this could be uranium containing U-235 inside the fuel rods, where the very energetic splitting of the uranium takes place, and thus energy is created in the form of heat. Around the fuel rods, you have water that gets turned into steam. And the steam eventually goes into a steam turbine, which drives a generator to produce electricity. Now, you might be wondering, how is the chain reaction controlled so that the reactor does not become an atomic bomb? The reaction is controlled by control rods that temper how much heat the reactor produces. To shut down a reactor, the control rods are inserted fully into the reactor, which can cease the chain reaction. Now, how do control rods do that? Control rods are made of a material that is very good at absorbing neutrons. So they end up absorbing the extra neutrons that are being produced in the nuclear reaction that propagate the chain reaction. So as the control rods absorb these extra neutrons, there is no way for the chain reaction to continue and the reaction stops. Now, because nothing is literally on fire, like in a coal plant, there is no carbon emission from this process. So the operation of a nuclear power plant is completely green, which is a good thing for Earth. The huge plumes you see from the cooling towers of the nuclear power plants is not pollution, but just water vapor from the condensation process of turning the steam back into water. So heat is being released into the atmosphere, not carbon dioxide or other greenhouse gases. Now, it should be noted that nuclear power isn't completely renewable, because you do end up consuming fuel, so to say. The fuel, U-235, is turned into waste products like krypton and barium and other elements of the periodic table. This is, in principle, fine because these elements exist naturally anyway. The issue is, however, that these waste products are generally radioactive isotopes of these elements, so we have to be careful with this waste, as it can be dangerous for humans due to radiation. However, this is not the most problematic part of using this for nuclear fuel because the half-life of these waste products is generally short, between a few days to 30 years, for the worst fission waste. So most of this waste turns into stable isotopes within a few years and becomes relatively safe. The bigger problem with using uranium for fuel is that they also create a lot of other waste products from transmutation. Transmutation is when an element absorbs a proton or a neutron and turns into a different element. So for example, when we mine uranium ore from Earth, it is mostly composed of uranium-238, which is fertile, meaning it cannot be split to undergo fission. Less than 1%, about 0.7% of natural uranium is fissile uranium-235, which can be split to power a nuclear power plant. This is one reason natural uranium has to be enriched so that we end up with at least a few percent of uranium-235 in it. This process is costly but necessary. This also means that most of the uranium fuel in a nuclear reactor is uranium-238 and not U-235. This U-238 absorbs neutrons, but instead of splitting it, undergoes transmutation into heavier elements like plutonium and americium. The problem is that this plutonium is very toxic, and not only that, it can also be used for nuclear weapons. Many people are against nuclear power plants specifically because of this latter fact, that the plutonium generated from waste can be used to make weapons of mass destruction. The bottom line is, most of these heavier elements created by transmutation of U-238 are not only nasty, but also have a long half-life. This means we end up having to store these waste products for hundreds, if not thousands of years, before they become safe. This is the big nuclear waste problem and a big reason why people don't like nuclear power. But thorium is different. Thorium is element number 90, so it's a slightly lighter element than uranium, which is element 92. First, it's much more abundant than uranium. In fact, we have more than 3 times more thorium on Earth than uranium. One reason we have more is because it's more stable than uranium, with a half-life of 14 billion years, compared to the most stable uranium having a half-life of 4.5 billion years. So it simply lasts longer before decaying. Not only that, but we can also more effectively use thorium for fuel. It's estimated that 1 ton of thorium can produce the same amount of power as 200 tons of uranium. The reason for this is because even enriched uranium only contains about 3 to 5% U-235, which is the fissile part. The remaining 95 to 97% is not only wasted, but undergoes transmutation to become more dangerous. But with thorium, you end up using almost all of it for fuel. Another aspect is that mining thorium is also safer and more efficient. This is because the brown ore monazite that contains thorium has higher concentrations of it than does the equivalent uranium ore. So the expensive process of enrichment is not necessary with thorium. Now you might ask, what kind of magic substance is this and why aren't we using it? Well, there are some issues. To start with, thorium is fertile, not fissile. In other words, you can't split it into two and make energy. So what the heck? Why are we even talking about this? Well, hold on a second. It can still be used. Thorium just has to be used in a different way than traditional uranium-fueled nuclear power plants. To make it work, you need to use what's called a breeding reactor. This is a kind of reactor that creates its own fuel from non-fissile material. How, you ask? Well, you start with thorium-232 from nature. Then you have a neutron source such that you add one neutron to get thorium-233. This isotope will undergo a beta minus decay so that a neutron in its nucleus becomes a proton, turning it into protactinium-233. This isotope is also not stable and will again undergo beta minus decay and transmute into uranium-233. So great, we started with thorium and now we've created uranium again? Isn't this what we were trying to avoid? Well, it turns out that just like uranium-235 that we use in uranium-fueled reactors, uranium-233 is also fissile, so we can split it and make a lot of energy. Now remember that in uranium reactors, the waste problem is not really splitting uranium-235 because the fission waste products have a relatively short lifetime. It's the transmutation of the U-238 that causes problems. Like U-235, uranium-233 also creates waste products that are relatively safe. But the difference is that with thorium, almost all of it is eventually used up in the fission process. There's very little U-238, like in uranium reactors, that can end up transmuting to americium and plutonium, which are radioactive and harmful to humans for long periods of time. This is a huge improvement over traditional uranium nuclear power plants. Now, the world isn't ideal, and neither is thorium. Some of the thorium in this process turns you into uranium-232 instead of uranium-233. Uranium-232 is not generally fissile. It's a contaminant and is very radiotoxic because it decays via a process that emits very high energy gamma rays, which are harmful to humans. So it has to be handled with care. One positive part is that the spent fuel rods of thorium containing uranium-232 contamination are not suitable for making nuclear weapons. So it makes these reactors peaceful and not an instrument for making weapons-grade nuclear material. So if thorium is so great, why doesn't everyone build these reactors? The answer is technical and political. First, engineering and building a commercial nuclear power plant of any kind, including a thorium power plant, is hard and expensive. Politically, there are at least two issues. First, it's hard to convince the public that these plants can be safe and reliable, given how the world witnessed the disasters at Fukushima in Japan, Chernobyl in Ukraine, and Three Mile Island in the United States over the last few decades. Secondly, because thorium doesn't produce military-grade products that can be used for nuclear weapons, it did not see much government funding, particularly during the Cold War era. But on the bright side, as with many things, who else but China is ahead of everybody else, having completed a new thorium test reactor last year and is heavily investing in thorium as a future power source. They may even have a plant ready to go by the end of this decade. Ultimately, we the people can decide if we want this. There are plenty of reserves in the world. India has the largest and the US is second. These two alone have enough to power the world for more than 1,000 years. So I hope this sheds some new light on an old subject and perhaps make you reconsider nuclear power as a solution to our increasing energy needs. And guys, I want to let you know that I have an announcement. If you want to meet me in person, I will be on stage at the Celebration of Science and Reason Conference in Vancouver, British Columbia on April 14th of 2022 this year, along with distinguished guests Sabina Hassenfelder and Lawrence Krauss. Tickets are on sale now for this event at pang.burn.com. The link is in the description. So I hope to see you there. If you like this video, do us a favor and subscribe. I'll see you in the next video, my friend.